In previous tutorials, we already touched upon the ARM7 core, the program flash memory, the PM bus interface, and the DPWM module in open loop mode. In this lab, we will focus on the digital filter used as the compensator in the closed loop system provided by the UCD3138 family of devices. We will also introduce the loop multiplexer, which controls the interconnections between the filters, front ends, and DPWM modules. We will also discuss DPWM operation in normal mode, where the filter output modulates the DPWM duty cycle. Thus, we will be one step closer to closing the loop. In the previous tutorial, we discussed the DPWM operation in open loop mode, where the PWM outputs were determined solely by the values of the DPWM registers. In this tutorial, we will discuss the DPWM operation in normal mode, where the DPWM outputs are modulated by a filter. I will then discuss the filter architecture and operation in more detail. We will also introduce the loop multiplexer. I recommend familiarizing yourself with the sections of the UCD3138 Digital Power Peripherals Programmer's Manual on the filters, the loop mux, and the DPWM normal mode operation. Now we will briefly introduce the UCD3138 filter and show how it fits in the control loop with the front end and DPWM modules. The filter in the UCD3138 family of devices is a PID filter with many enhancements for power supply control. These will be discussed shortly. It generally takes the output of the error ADC, which is a signed 9-bit value, as an input. The output of the filter feeds the high resolution DPWM module, which produces the pulse width modulated outputs for the power stage switches. The filter output can be used to modulate the DPWM period and or duty cycle. A sample trigger is generally fed back from a DPWM module to a front-end error ADC, so as the input signal can be sampled at a particular point in the PWM cycle. When the sample trigger is asserted, a front-end calculation is initiated by triggering the error ADC. When the error ADC output has been updated, a filter calculation is automatically initiated. Finally, the DPWM is updated using the new filter output. Oversampling can be set for 2, 4, or 8 times the sampling rate, which is set by the value in the sampling rate register. Generally, the filter input is driven from the output of the front-end error ADC. It is also possible to drive the filter from the ARM7 core for open loop testing. In this lab, this is what we will be doing. In the last tutorial, we discussed DPWM operation in open loop mode. I will now discuss normal mode DPWM operation. In normal mode, the filter output determines the pulse width on DPWM output A. DPWM output B fits into the rest of the switching period with a dead time separating it from the DPWM output A on time. The rising edge of DPWM output A is controlled by the value in the event 1 register. We covered the 4 event registers in the previous tutorial. The falling edge of DPWM output B is controlled by the value in the event 4 register. The two edges in between, namely the falling edge of DPWM output A and the rising edge of DPWM output B, are controlled by the filter. The dead time between output A and output B is controlled by subtracting the value in the event 2 register from the value in the event 3 register. More specifically, the falling edge of the DPWM output A is controlled by both the filter duty value and the value in a register called Cycle Adjust A. Cycle Adjust A can be used to adjust pulse widths on individual phases of a multi-phase system. So the falling edge of DPWM A is set by event 1 plus the filter duty plus Cycle Adjust A. DPWMB's rising edge is then equal to this value plus the dead time. Now I will briefly overview some of the other signals in normal mode. The adaptive sample triggers can be used to sample in the middle of the on time for an average output, or at the end of the on time to minimize phase delay. Sample trigger 1 can be used to provide a sample to a front end which is fixed relative to the PWM period. Blanking A begin and blanking A end can be used to blank out noise from the MOSFET turn on at the beginning of the PWM period. Sample trigger 2 can be used to provide a sample to a front end which is fixed relative to the PWM period. Blanking B could be used at the turn off time of DPWM output B. The phase trigger can be used to synchronize multiple DPWM modules. It can be a fixed value from the phase shift register, or it can be controlled by the filter output. The signals which can be routed to other modules are highlighted here. We will now discuss the additions we need to make to the DPWM module initialization code. Please note that the code for this tutorial is a continuation of the code for lab 2. First, we will discuss the front-end sample trigger. This originates in a DPWM module and is routed back to a front-end module. This trigger is used to initiate a conversion of the input signal by the error ADC in the front-end. We will configure DPWM0 to initiate a conversion on front-end 0. We have two choices in each DPWM module for the sample trigger source. Sample trigger 1 and sample trigger 2. Sample trigger 2 is controlled by the value in the sample trigger 2 register and so is always at a fixed point in the PWM period. For sample trigger 1, there are four options. We can sample at a fixed point in the PWM period, controlled by the value in the DPWM Samp Trig 1 register. There is also the choice of three adaptive sample triggers to sample at three different parts of the on time. In this lab, we use sample trigger 1. So we set the bit sample trig 1 enable, which enables sample trigger 1. We set the sample point to be fixed at 3/4 of the PWM period. Note that the value of sample trig 1 mode, which selects the source for sample trigger 1, does not need to be modified here, as the default is 0. A value of 0 selects the fixed sample point set by the value in the DPWM Samp Trig 1 register, which is what we want. The PWM mode bits select the mode for the DPWM. There are five options. We set it to 0 to select normal mode. The event upsell bit enables four different modes of DPWM event updating. The DPWM needs a period of 72 nanoseconds to update its timing for the next period. During this period, it takes the latest filter outputs and any firmware changes to register values and recalculates the timing of the DPWM signals. We set it so as this update occurs at the end of the PWM period. In the past, the filter was called a control law accelerator. So for historical reasons, the filter enable bit is called CLA enable. This bit, when set, causes the DPWM to take its input from a filter. Otherwise, the DPWM output comes from the DPWM registers only. The UCD3138 filter is a PID filter with many enhancements for power supply control. It has three main stages. Firstly, a PID stage. Secondly, a stage which adds the output of the three branches together and saturates, scales, and clamps the output as required. The final stage is split into two sections, which permit the filter output to be matched to the PWM duty cycle and period. Here is the block diagram of the PID stage with bit width information. Note that in most cases, the precision of the results is preserved at the highest level until rounding and clamping at the output of the filter. All values shown are signed numbers, with the most significant bit being the sign bit. All are treated as being normalized to 1. The main input to the filter is a 9-bit signed value from an error ADC. It goes to the input for filter calculations. The previous input sample is stored and used as an input to the integral and differential branches. The filter input, XN, also goes to a digital limit comparator. This allows for non-linear filter calculations with up to 7 different coefficient sets selected by the XN value. This can be used to change the compensation of the filter with different input error ranges. The XN value is used directly as an input to the proportional branch of the filter. It is multiplied by the 16-bit signed KP coefficient, and the 24-bit result is used as the output of the P branch. When multiplying two signed numbers in binary arithmetic, an extra sign bit is generated. Because of this, 9 bits times 16 bits gives 24 meaningful bits, not 25. No clamp is needed on the proportional branch. It is self-limiting because it has no memory. There are two options for the use of XN in the integrator input. The current XN can be used by itself, or the current XN can be added with the previous XN-1 by setting the KI adder mode bit. The XN value, or the XN plus XN-1 value, is multiplied by the KI coefficient. The output of this multiplication will always fit within 24 bits. This value is then added to the existing I value. The hardware will automatically clamp it at a 24-bit signed number, and there are high and low clamp registers available, which can be used to clamp it to lower values. On the differential branch, XN-1 is subtracted from XN. The result is then multiplied by the coefficient KD, giving a 24-bit signed number. The differential branch has an additional pole added after this multiplication, giving more control of the filter response to permit better matching to the power supply plant. This D alpha branch acts as an integrator on the output of the D branch. With each filter calculation, the 24-bit result of the previous D and D alpha calculation is multiplied by the 9-bit K alpha. This gives a 32-bit signed result. To match the 24-bit data path, this must be rounded back down to 24 bits. This is the one rounding that actually takes place in the filter before the filter output. There is also a simple clamp to prevent the K output from going outside a 24-bit signed number. Because of the integral element for the alpha stage, it is possible for it to exceed this range. In this lab, we will use the proportional branch only. Here is the block diagram of the next stage of the filter. The S0.23 notation means a 24-bit number with 1 sign bits to the left of the binary point and 23 bits to the right of the point. First, the P, I and D outputs are added together, giving a potential 26-bit result. Then, saturation logic clamps this back down to 24 bits. The output of the saturation section goes to a programmable shifter, which can be programmed for 8 different shifts, including no shift at all. This can be used to compensate for the scaling of the filter coefficients. After the scaling, there is a clamp with independent clamp high and clamp low values, which are set by writing to registers. This clamp also has status bits, which are set when the clamp limits are exceeded. The final stage of the filter converts the filter output to match the input requirements of the DPWM. 2 different calculations are performed sequentially using the same multiplier but with different settings. This stage does the calculation to provide a DPWM duty value. At the start of this stage, the PID output is multiplied by one of several 14-bit unsigned numbers, giving a 38-bit result. For the filter duty calculation, there are 4 numbers which can be used. We use the PWM period, so as the filter output modulates the duty cycle of DPWM0. After the multiplication, there is a 38-bit signed result. Negative values are clamped to 0 and the sign bit is removed. This gives a 37-bit positive result. This number is rounded to the 18 most significant bits. The duty value is clamped using the values in the filter output clamp high register and the filter output clamp low register. After that, the filter duty value is used by the DPWM as a time value. It is considered a 14.4-bit value, with the low 4 bits going to the high resolution section of the DPWM. So the resolution of the filter duty value is 250 picoseconds. This is a block diagram of the part of the output stage that does the calculation to provide a DPWM period value. For the filter period calculation, only 2 numbers can be selected for the multiplication stage. The filter period value gets no clamp. The DPWM period does not support high resolution, so the low 4 bits from the 18-bit result are truncated. The filter period only presents the high 14 bits to the DPWM, giving a resolution of 4 nanoseconds. In this lab, we will leave the loop open for now and manually feed values into the filter via the CPU over the PM bus interface using the GUI hyperknob. Thus, we set the bit called use CPU sample in the filter control register to 1. We then set the CPU sample to be 1/4 of the full scale input range of the filter. Remember that the filter input is 9 bits, and the most significant bit is a sine bit, so 1/4 of the full scale range is 64. For the filter duty cycle output stage, we set the DPWM period to be the output multiplier, so as the filter modulates the duty cycle of the PWM period. We then set the local filter enable bit in the filter control register. Note that the filter is not enabled until the front end and the DPWM modules are globally enabled by setting the relevant bits in the global enable register. The loop mux controls the connections between the different parts of the control loop, the front end, the filter, and the DPWM. In this series of tutorials, we will configure the loop mux to drive DPWM0 with filter 0 and filter 0 with front end 0. We will also route the sample trigger from DPWM0 back to front end 0, even though we are not using front end 0 in this tutorial. The loop mux also has a global enable register, which we will configure to enable front end 0 and DPWM0 simultaneously. We want to select filter 0 to drive DPWM0. We set the DPWM0 filter select field accordingly. Recall that we have already configured the sample trigger output of DPWM0. We set it to a fixed value of 3/4 of the period and are using sample trigger 1. Now we must configure the loop mux so as the DPWM0 sample trigger is routed back to front end 0. Note that we are not using front end 0 in this tutorial. Instead, we are using a CPU sample to drive the filter, but the sample trigger still needs to be routed to it as it also initiates a filter computation. Any of the sample triggers from the 4 DPWMs can be routed back to any of the 3 front ends as shown here. We wish to connect the sample trigger from DPWM0 back to front end 0, so we set the relevant bit to 1 in the sample trigger control register. We want to enable DPWM0 and front end 0 simultaneously. We can do this using a temporary structure. Note that we are enabling front-end zero. As we have already mentioned, we are not using it, but the sample trigger is routed through it. The defaults for the front end are okay for use for now. Also note that the filter does not have a global enable bit in the global enable register. It is enabled when the front end that is driving it is enabled and a sample trigger is received from the DPWM. Here is main.c. It is a continuation of the Lab 2 solution. This is the function that initializes DPWM0 with the additions and changes for Lab 3 highlighted. Here are the functions that initialize the loop mux. Here is the variable that is used to adjust the filter input using the GUI's memory debugger hyperknob. Here is the filter initialization function. Here are the tasks for Lab 3. Initialize the KP coefficient so as the input to the filter passes through the proportional branch unchanged. Initialize the KI and KD coefficients so as the integral and differential branches are disabled. Also set the K alpha pole in the differential branch so it is disabled. Here is the main function. Make sure to tie the fault 3 pin to ground so as the checksum is not cleared at startup. Here, the hyperknob variable is initialized to the value of the CPU sample that is fed into the filter. Here is the main loop. The PM bus handler is in there as usual. Here, the CPU sample value that is driving the filter is mapped to the hyperknob variable. So when the variable RAM CPU sample is changed using the memory debugger hyperknob over the PM bus interface, the value in the CPU sample register is updated with this value on every pass through the main loop. Here is the solution. The KI, KD, and K alpha coefficients are all set to zero to disable these branches. The KP coefficient is set to hexadecimal 7FFF. Recall that KP is a 16-bit signed number normalized to 1. So we set the sign bit to 0 and set the other bits to 1 to obtain the maximum positive value, which is almost 1. Here is the memory debugger hyperknob. First click refresh to read the value of the variable into the GUI. it should be equal to 64, which is what we initialized the CPU sample to. Click the AutoWrite checkbox so as the changes made to the variable in the memory debugger are written to the part immediately over the PMBus interface. To increase and decrease the variable value by the step size, which is set by the comments in the code, click on the plus and minus buttons. Here are the outputs DPWM0A and DPWM0B. The rising edge of DPWM0A is set by the value in the Event 1 register, and the falling edge of DPWM0B is set by the value in the Event 4 register. So these two edges are fixed. The two edges in between are controlled by the filter output. Here we increase the value of the filter input. As can be seen, the falling edge of DPWM0A moves out, so the duty cycle of DPWMA increases, and the rising edge of DPWM0B also moves out, so the duty cycle of DPWMB decreases. Now we will decrease the value of the filter input, and the opposite happens. Now I will demo how to add variables to the watch list in the GUI hyperknob. Click on the gold star on the left of the variable name to add it to the watch list. Add the hyperknob variable RAM CPU sample to the watch list. Scroll up to DPWM0 regs. Expand and scroll down to DPWM filter duty read. Add this to the watch list. This register contains an 18-bit field called filter duty, which contains the value at the output of the filter duty stage that is fed to DPWM0. To see the watch list, click on the watch list tab on the top left of the memory debugger. Note that both variables are in the watch list window. Note that as we increase the input to the filter with the hyperknob, the filter duty cycle output increases. As we decrease the input to the filter duty cycle output decreases. Note that as the filter input exceeds half scale or 128, the calculated rising edge of DPWMB exceeds event 4. If the rising edge of DPWMB exceeds event 4, you get shoot through, as can be seen here when both DPWMA and DPWMB are on at the same time. This could have catastrophic consequences in a real power supply. One way around this is to use an appropriate clamp on the filter output. Look at the commented out lines in main.c in the filter initialization function. Uncomment these lines, build the code, and download the code onto the part. With the code changes, we can increase the filter all the way to the max without shoot-through, as can be seen here. Here is the duty cycle output stage of the filter. Previously, we selected the DPWM period as the output multiplier. So as the filter output modulates the duty cycle of the DPWM period. In the code changes that we just made, we changed the output multiplier to kcomp0. This is a 14-bit value, which we set equal to the period divided by 2 to avoid shoot-through. Note that we have to right-shift the value by 4 to adjust for the different alignments between kcomp0 and the DPWM period register. This code change is a better option for handling the shoot-through versus using a clamp on the filter output, as it uses the full dynamic range of the filter.